Hi to everyone, my name is Andres Rodriguez and I'm a PhD student from the University of Melbourne in Australia. My talk will be about the dynamics of our continent collision, in particular, the role of lithospheric mantle dynamics in controlling the spatiotemporal evolution of stress and the formation of basins in the continental plate. The tool of my preference for addressing this research is 2D numerical modeling in the underworld geodynamic code. Previous research suggests that the spatiotemporal evolution of stress in accretionary continental margins can be controlled by lithospheric mantle dynamics. In the cartoon below, where I showed you the temporal evolution of an accretionary continental margin, you can see that episodes of extension can be related to the sinking of the subducting slab through the upper mantle and episodes of compression to the anchoring of the subducting slab in the upper-lower mantle transition zone. However, the relationship between lithospheric mantle dynamics and arc continent collision remains poorly understood. This motivated me to investigate the role of lithospheric mantle dynamics in the spatiotemporal evolution of stress in arc continent collision settings and the formation of basins in the continental plate. The motivation of this research are the Northwestern North America and Northwestern South America arc continent collisions. Both arc collisional margins consist of a subducting oceanic plate, a collided intra-oceanic arc in orange, a continental plate in light blue, and a continental craton in dark blue. Across the black line and in the images below, you can see the seismic tomography beneath these two arc collisional margins. As you can see, both tomographies suggest that the subducting slab remains anchored in the upper-lower mantle transition zone. Therefore, the aim of this research is to understand the evolution of lithospheric mantle dynamics in arc continent collision settings, to understand the role of lithospheric mantle dynamics in the spatial temporal evolution of stress, and to understand the role of density contrast in the evolution of the stress regime, because previous research has suggested that the density contrast play a role in subduction collisional dynamics by promoting crustal flow. As I previously mentioned you, these three aims will be explored by using 2D numerical modeling. The model setup that we implemented for our numerical modeling is the one you can see in this cartoon. We considered a 3,600 kilometers in width model box and 800 kilometers in height model box. This model box accounts for the upper mantle, lower mantle transition zone and contains a subducting plate, an intra-oceanic arc, a continental plate, and a continental craton. In addition to this, subduction in these models is seeded by this dipping slab segment. We assume free slip in all the boundaries, and we then applied any velocity boundary condition in the left, in the right, or left boundary. Therefore, forces in the model emerge from initial material properties. Similarly, the arc in these simulations is fully grown at the start of the models. Therefore, we don't account for crustal growth. And finally, these models are purely mechanical, therefore we neither account for the effect of thermal diffusion. Because our models are purely mechanical, the effect of temperature on initial material properties is averaged by averaging the material properties in layers of equal thickness. For the case of the subducting plate, you can see to the left and in blue, the relative viscosity, which is averaging the distinct layers considered for the subducting plate respect to a mantle, and the relative density to the right in red. Positive values in the relative density refer to layers which are denser than the mantle, and negative values to layers which are bulgier than the mantle. The same here, we have the properties for the arc, for the continental plate, and for the continental craton. In order to address the question of what is the role of density contrast in the stress regime evolution in arc continent collision, we assume the following structure for the intra-oceanic arc. We assume an upper crust with the composition of basalt, which is 7 kilometers in thickness, and a middle lower arc crust, which has the composition of tonalite and gabbro, and has a variable thickness. So what we consider a thickness is the combination of these two crustal levels. Then we perform a series of simulations when we only vary the arc thickness based on natural examples. And this interval of hardness represents a spectrum of density contrast between the arc and the continental plate. As you can see in the images below, the buoyancy of the arc increases as the arc thickness does. Now, results from this 2D numerical purely mechanical modeling shows that arc-continent collision can be followed by two dynamic mechanisms. The first one of them is arc transference plus slab anchoring in dense arcs, and the second one of them is slab breakoff in buoyant arcs. Now I will show you the evolution of dense arcs. As you can see, the onset of slab anchoring results in a return flow. Then initial collision is followed by the growth of a orogenic root, which, following the transference of the arc to a riding plate, results in the relaxation of this orogenic root and the release of a gravitational flow directing from the arc towards the surrounding subducting and continental plate lithosphere. Now I will show you the evolution of buoyant arcs. So similarly to dense arcs, the onset of slab anchoring results in a return flow, and also collision results in the formation of an orogenic root. However, differently to dense arcs, in buoyant arcs, we have the breakoff of the subducting slab, which triggers the spring of the orogenic root and the retreat of both the subducting and overriding plates from the collisional zone. Now I will show you the spatiotemporal evolution of stress in both dense and buoyant arcs. So we have the evolution of dense arcs to the left and the evolution of buoyant arcs to the right. These plots show the horizontal component of the deviatoric stress tensor, and blue colors map for the locations where we have compression and red colors to a location where we have extension. I want you to focus your attention to the third and fourth stages. In the case of dense arcs to the left, you can see that in the third stage and following arc transference and slab anchoring, localized compression towards the subducting plate and the trench, while the stress regime in the continental plate is shifted to extension. In the last stage, we observe fluctuations in the stress regime in the continental plate in different events of compression and extension, because different events of folding in the subducting slab. In the case of buoyant arcs, and in contrast, a slab breakoff results in the retreat of both the subducting plate and the continental plate. And this also happens in the last stage. In summary, dense arcs, which are controlled by arc transference and slab anchoring, results in the localization of compression towards the subducting plate and in fluctuating epitopes of compression and extension in the continental plate. In the case of buoyant arcs, slab breakoff results in the congestion of the subduction zone, the passive retreat of the subducting plate from the collisional zone, and finally, lithospheric extension and retreat of the continental overriding plate. The simultaneous occurrence of extension and compression observed in both cases is driven by the relaxation of the orogenic root. Now, I will discuss the role of lithospheric mantle dynamics and the stress evolution. Previous research suggests that slab anchoring results in a return flow that increases compression and lithospheric thickening. When the arc crust is dragged to deep crustal levels, it releases a gravitational flow following both arc transference and slab breakoff. This gravitational flow, in the case of dense arcs, localized compressions towards the trench and the subducting plate and shifts the stress regime in the continental plate to extension. And in the case of buoyant arcs, drives just the retreat of the overriding of the subducting plate, and also in the overriding plate, accompanied by lithospheric extension. In order to conclude, arc-continent collision results in two dynamic mechanisms: arc transference plus slab anchoring and slab breakoff, which occurrence is controlled by density contrast between the arc and the continental plate. Lithospheric extension can occur simultaneously with compression due to arc transference plus slab anchoring or slab anchoring followed by slab breakoff. And finally, slab anchoring allows the simultaneous occurrence of extension and compression in arc-continent collision settings, promoting the formation of basins in the continental plate.